Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Taliban. Within hours of complete withdrawal of the American troops, terrorizing visuals started emerging from Kabul. Civilians hanging from choppers, dreaded Talibani gunmen firing indiscriminately, violent door-to-door reprisals, gunning down of resistance forces, threat of violence against women, and open intimidation of minorities. For all the legitimacy that Taliban attempts to seek, these visuals must be played out to the entire world, and their farce must end tonight. Yes, we must not forget the civilians of Afghanistan. This 10 window is a peek into the life of an ordinary Afghan citizen. Economic unrest, a city in tatters, people thronging at various borders to escape, gunmen roaming on the streets, an imposition of Sharia law that denies the basic human rights of citizens, especially women. Amidst this sheer despondency, the Taliban has the audacity of seeking legitimacy. A pleading Talib official who met Indian envoy in Qatar for the same reason was told by India to stop spreading terror, provide safe passage for the citizens, and safeguard minorities. Ministry of External Affairs, in its statement, clearly indicated that Taliban sought the meeting. Clearly for India, the safe passage of its citizens stuck in Afghanistan is of paramount concern. This meeting, however, has been seen as a change of stand by the Modi government. The opposition accusing the government of adopting double standards vis-a-vis Taliban. Listen in.
All these jack-in-the-boxes of BJP spokesperson or the leaders should really shut up now and see the Modi government has spoken to a Taliban representative and stop calling anyone opposing as Talibani. If that is the case, then we'll also have to call them Talibani, because Modi government, the ambassador of India in Qatar, has met a representative of Taliban.
We appreciate the Taliban's statement also, which has come, namely that India is an important country nearby in the neighborhood, and Afghanistan's new regime would like to have cordial relationship with India.
Kya Bharat Sarkar ne Taliban se baatcheet karna shuru kar diya hai? और अगर बातचीत करना शुरू कर दी है तो क्या तालिबान की हुकूमत को रिकॉग्नाइज कर लिया है? और भारत के अंदर वो लोग जो तालिबान का नाम लेते थे और उनके खिलाफ एफआईआर हो जाती थी, देशद्रोही बन जाते थे, अब वो दोबारा से देशभक्त बनेंगे कि नहीं बनेंगे?
So the legitimate question on the news hour tonight is, government legitimizing Taliban argument valid? That's the question and the debate. Hashtag India Taliban Meet. The debate coming up on the other side.
You're watching the News Hour at 9. Debate number 1 on Times Now. Super Prime Time.
And joining me tonight, Sanju Varma, national spokesperson of the BJP. Major General Dhruv Katoch, Director, India Foundation, joining the debate tonight. Sanjay Jha, suspended Congress leader. Vivek Srivastava, political analyst. But my first question goes to my friend, Dr. Anand Ranganathan, author who's joining the show. And Dr. Anand Ranganathan, I want to ask you, why do you think this is legitimization of Taliban? Simply because there has been a meeting between a High Commissioner in Doha and the Taliban. The Taliban sought the meeting, and we have Indians stuck there. What did you expect the government to do? To have no conversation going forward to try and rescue people from Afghanistan and, of course, Indians stuck there?
No, good evening, Alka. You're absolutely right. I'll be very brief, in fact, because I've already elaborated previously on this matter. There are two issues here. Number one, as you rightly put it, the Taliban hold all the cards right now because we haven't yet evacuated all our personnel from Afghanistan. So according to me, we have to have some sort of relations with them. I'm a layman speaking here. Till the time that we evacuate every Indian from Afghanistan. Post-evacuation, I'm very certain and very resolute in my view that we must not have any relations with this terrorist state of Afghanistan. Because remember, when they were pining for relations with us back in the mid-1990s, and they were singing the same paeans as they are now, that, oh, we are different. Of course, they weren't different. In fact, they were the hub of terror for the next 10 years. So we don't, you know, we've seen through them. And as you know, Navika, second point, very briefly, I'm against India having any relations with any dictatorship or any barbaric regime, period. In fact, you may recall last year when we were having all that China embargo, I proposed that we must prepare in the near future or maybe the long future to deal with only democratic nations as a rule, the so-called D60, as I called them. Because only that will force all the dictatorships to become democracies when they see nobody is trading. And then, of course, right now in reality, in real politics, you may say that's simply not possible. But what I don't like are double standards. So this caveat also is there that I don't want India to have to do anything with this Taliban-ruled Afghanistan barbarian. There is a nation, Navika. They implement Sharia. They prohibit music. They enforce burqa. They segregate sexes. They behead activists. They hang poets. They flog gays. They stone adulterers. They dismember journalists. They do $40 billion USD worth of trade with the USA every year. They do $10 billion USD trade with India every year. They are not the Taliban. You want to guess the nation?
Do you want to respond to that, Sanju Verma?
Yes. You know, Navika, there are a couple of things here. First and foremost, if you read the statement, you know, that your own channel has put out, dated 31st August, the meeting between Deepak Mittal, the Indian envoy to Qatar, and Mohammed Abbas from the Taliban's end, the meeting was held at the behest of the Taliban. Now, does this meeting mean that the Modi government is willing to negotiate and compromise with a terror militia? The categorical answer is a no. Then, pray, the question arises, why did you even meet? To that, the simple answer is this, that as you and me speak now, there are still about 140 Hindus and Sikhs who were denied to leave, you know, Afghanistan by Taliban. And they are still there. Their security, their safety is something that is paramount to the Modi government. So at this point in time, what we categorically told the Talibani representative, Mohammed Abbas, was this. We do not want you to export terror from the Afghan soil. We do not want you to export the Lashkar, Jamaat-ul-Dawah and Jaish-e-Mohammed loyalists to the Indian soil, point number one. Point number two, we clearly spoke that the rescue and evacuation of people there who are willing to come to India, who are Indian nationals, and also people who are not Indian nationals, are Afghan nationals, but are minorities, Hindus, Sikhs, Parsis, Jains, Buddhists, what have you. We want them to safely come back to India. Now, tell me one thing. Engagement is one thing. Having a transactional commitment from a militia group that our citizens will come back safely to our soil. I think the Modi government needs to be applauded for it rather than being castigated for it. And one more thing. I think nobody should have any doubts about the fact that terror and talk don't go together. I clearly remember Prime Minister Modi has said this from the ramparts of the BRICS plenary session at Goa in 2016. He reinforced this while he met Jawans during Diwali at Jaisalmer last year. And I think that stand continues. But at this point in time, sometimes real politics is also about ensuring that your people come first. And don't forget that while the presidency of India with the United Nations Security Council ends today, something which no political analyst is telling you is this, that India for the next 1.5 years still has the chairmanship of the committee which decides on sanctions and travel restrictions. So I think the Modi government has ample latitude at its disposal. Under the chairmanship, you know, that India enjoys with respect to sanctions, we will play a crucial role. India will be the fulcrum.
Well, we're waiting for that. But Sanjay Jha seems to be shaking his head. He's not convinced. While we are getting visuals right now of the Taliban surrounding the Kabul airport, after the Americans have left from Kabul, there are also visuals of Taliban celebrating their victory at the central mosque in Lashkar Gah. That is the visual that we're just going to put out on our screens right now. And these visuals are coming in from the mosque. There are four visuals also, which if we can play them, they're available right now. These visuals clearly show that there is a celebration, and there is no way, Sanjay Jha, that anybody can be under any false illusions that the Taliban will be some kind of a good force in our neighborhood. Everybody can foresee that our problems, in our backyard are only going to increase between Afghanistan and Pakistan. I think we have our challenges ahead. But to begin to question even a meeting at this point in time, the question is, what's the option? How do you actually extricate some of the people who are stuck there, some of the minorities who are stuck there, some of people who want to get out of Kabul at this point in time? Because frankly, there is a Taliban rule, and everybody knows what their laws and what their attitude is. What do you do?
Well, Navika, there are a couple of prescriptions that have to be, different from the standard boilerplate that happens in diplomacy. But a couple of points here. I don't think, the BJP spokesperson is aware, but it has already been reported that back channel communications with the Taliban were happening as early as June or even late May. Okay. And it is pretty much on record that the government was already in a very active engagement with Taliban, because the US had already announced the withdrawal of troops by the end of August. Number one. Number two, very critical. In the United Nations Security Council, under the presidency of India, the Taliban has been given a huge concession by not being linked with the word terror. And what an irony, Navika, because you are equally very deft in following international politics, that you are talking about an organization that is renowned for being a brutal terrorist outfit. And some of the images that you showed are probably symptomatic of the ramifications that are going to play out in Afghanistan and Kabul in the weeks and months ahead. It's frightening. I agree that there is a security and investment issue that India needs to address. But this is why you need to have a diplomatic troubleshooting options before you. Now, think about it, Navika. The last time the Taliban were in power after the Soviets left, three countries recognized them. There were obviously Pakistan, there was the United Arab Emirates, and there was Iran. Is India going to be now joining because of this so-called perception of Taliban 2.0? Can I just speak without interruption, madam? Is India going to be now legitimizing a terrorist outfit? And I'll tell you why it's scary. I'll tell you why it's scary, Navika.
Sanju Varma, I'll give you time to counter. I will give you time to counter. Allow him to complete his point. I'll come back to you.
Yeah. The fact, Navika, is that everyone and his auntie knows that the government of Taliban is basically a Pakistan proxy. You read Barack Obama's autobiography, where the former president actually in writing concedes that Pakistan has been responsible not just for having Mr. Osama bin Laden protected there, but actually ensuring that the Afghan government is weak. Now, I'll tell you why I worry about Indian diplomacy here. If Mr. Jaishankar or Mr. Modi's government believe that you are going to be actually creating a new relationship with the Taliban, with Pakistan, China, the two countries with whom we risk a two-front war every couple of weeks, that's a conversation that happens at the military level, and Taliban, Pakistan, China, and Taliban, and India believes it can just kind of forge some kind of a warm equation, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. And I do agree with you, because on your show, I think you and Rahul have discussed that. Yes, Kashmir is going to be a very
sensitive issue for us because
may
the Lashkar-e Toiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed.
Absolutely. What you say is, I think, the obvious, Sanjay Jha, and nobody is under any illusion, as I said, and our problems in Kashmir definitely are going to be increasing. There is no other way to pretend otherwise. But to begin to question, it's all very well to sit in the opposition or somewhere in between and point fingers and worry about foreign policy. It's a totally different ballgame to be sitting on the hot seat to take the decisions when you are in a snake pit, with China, Pakistan and Taliban on the, three sides trying to surround you. And Sanju Verma, the dangers are there. The dangers are there. You have to be able to convince the country that you're in control and not the other way around.
Well, Navika, thank
you.
Is an option.
Navika,
there is an option.
Please now, Sanjay Jha, you had a long, long speech.
Just a minute, just give me
Navika,
seconds.
I will make half the time that Sanjay Jha, he rambled on and on and on, but I don't think he made any
sense. Its influence with Russia to try and make sure Russia is very much...
Sanjay Jha, wait for your time. Your foreign policy doctrine, I'll come back to it after Sanju Verma has responded.
Now, Sanjay Jha, listen to me carefully. Everybody and his bald, suspended uncle from Congress need to hear this, including people like you. First and foremost, when there are matters pertaining to the safety and security of our minorities, that is supreme. And we will have to extract commitment from a certain group, but we are not going to negotiate with them. There is a difference between a transactional commitment, extracting a transactional commitment, and engaging in a bilateral dialogue. Please understand the difference. Point number two. Do you know, Navika, which was the country which first asked the United Nations Security Council to condemn the Talibani takeover of Kabul and other associated cities, including Herat and Jalalabad? It was the Modi government. Which was the country which asked G7 countries last week to unilaterally condemn the terror unleashed by the Taliban? It was the Modi government. Which was the country which raised the issue of the terror group Taliban taking over Kabul at the United Nations Human Commission? It was the Modi government, including the UNHCR. Now, I want to say one thing. If we do not rescue these 140 Sikhs and Hindus who are still caught there, trying to flee, and, are at the mercy of the Taliban, what will headline screen tomorrow on television channels? And
so you are actually saying, Sanju Verma, that this is something that you are doing for headline management, Sanju Verma. Is that what you want to say? Are you doing this for headline management? Well, headline management may be a lot easier than future management of a country, its foreign policy, and saving India from our so-called neighbors in this area, the story of which is going from bad to worse. But let me get in Major General Dhruv Katoch. Major General Dhruv Katoch, right now, the way I look at it, let's forget the rhetoric and the politics. Let's just move that aside. What people in India are asking tonight is, where does India go from here? Are we going to do business with a state and with Taliban in control? Because we've always identified that there will be zero conversation with terrorists. Are we going to change that stand? That's question number one, primary question that is topmost on people's mind. Are we going to do business with terrorists in Taliban? Are we going to do business with Pakistan? Is that a change in India's position? Are we going to legitimize the Taliban takeover, which takes place tomorrow? What is India's policy going to be? Because right now, there is a bit of flip and there is a bit of flop, and we really don't know where we are going.
Thank you, Navika. Navika, let me put my stand very clear as far as this is concerned. Now, there are a few things which need to be understood. The first of it is, I think,
yes, go on, Major General.
No, there is a huge difference between there is a huge difference between engagement and recognition. I understand that as far as the Taliban is concerned, they are desperately seeking India's recognition. That is not going to happen. But I think any responsible power must keep lines of communication open and engage. Now, when we are looking at Afghanistan, I think the problem which people need to understand is whoever puts his hand inside this state, inside this country, is playing a losing game. There are no winners in Afghanistan, whether it's the United States, Russia, China, India, Iran, or name it. Everyone is a loser. Now, in this game, I don't think it will be advisable for India to say, we will not be a part of this game. That, okay, we are going to take a high moral stand and stay out. Real politics does not work that way. We have to engage, which is totally different from recognizing this country. Now, if you had to break relations with countries which are supporting terrorism, we should have broken relations with Pakistan right at the time of independence. And we should have declared them a pariah state and refused to have contact with them. But yet, we will have all these people coming and saying, no, Pakistan is a different kettle of fish. No, it is not the different kettle of fish. Afghanistan has never been the problem. The problem has always been Pakistan. And yet, we talk with Pakistan. We have an embassy in Pakistan. And here people are saying, don't even talk to the Afghan Taliban. No, you know, Navika, it is a bit more than simply getting our people out. We have a very strong engagement with the people of Afghanistan, and we need to remain engaged with the people of Afghanistan. And the only way we can do that as of now is to talk with whomsoever is ruling there. And this is something which I feel is important. And let us not forget it. Let us not get involved in rhetoric. Because if, just perchance, if the government had said we will refuse to talk, the very same people who are shouting and bickering here, they would have actually said something the opposite. Now, that is not the way a rational conversation goes. One last point I want to give. In the strategic circles where I work in, there are many, many people, many very prominent voices in the Indian strategic think tanks who are actually stating something that we should actually recognize Taliban immediately. I've never agreed with that view. But please understand, those views also exist. So let multiple views exist. Let us debate them out. But in my personal view, engagement is different to legitimizing and granting recognition to the Taliban.
Vivek Srivastav, as Major General Katoch pointed out, engagement is something you cannot avoid. You are in the real world. There are people stuck there. And you have a relationship with the Afghan people. Engagement is different from legitimizing the Taliban as a government in Afghanistan. Why are people in the opposition jumping? There is no easy solution. Why don't we realize that? Whether it was Modi on the hot seat or whether it was somebody else, it was a tough solution, tough problem which has no easy solutions. So Vivek Srivastav, there is no instant coffee kind of a solution available here.
Absolutely. I agree with you. But however, you see, now there are two more things I would like to say. Number one, February 2020, Doha, Qatar, when there were negotiations going on between the Trump government and the Taliban, you know, and the Americans were, you know, negotiating that they want to move back. So one of the major clauses was that, you know, the atrocities against the women should not be there. And the second point was that Taliban should not have any track with ISIS and other organizations like Al-Qaeda, which are anti-United States of America. And many other European countries, Japan, Australia, including India, non-state actors of RP, you know, from our government also, they were sort of, you know, backing out this agreement. So we were aware of it all along. So acting now, you know, as if, you know, something suddenly happened, that is not done. Secondly, in the all-party meeting that just recently concluded, it was decided that a wait-and-watch policy should be observed, which is what the Modi government is doing. And today it is 31st of August. The Americans are out only today. So there has to be given more time before you can actually finalize some strong foreign policy. But one thing that is very certain is that trusting the Americans and towing the American line, that is absolutely wrong.
Is trusting Anand Ranganathan
over here, thank God, he's not in the
Chinese
ministry.
A better option?
He says that India,
is trusting
India
the Chinese a better option? You're saying Americans
as
if...
I'm telling you one thing.
You know, you're talking about the Americans as if trusting the Chinese is an option, Dr. Anand Ranganathan?
I'll tell you. Please, Vivek, Dr. Anand Ranganathan is saying that India should not have any contact with anyone, which is not a democracy, which means आप सऊदी अरेबिया से बात नहीं करेंगे, आप गल्फ की कंट्री से बात नहीं करेंगे, आप चाइना से बात नहीं करेंगे, आपके यहाँ तेल कहाँ से आएगा, आपके फॉरन पॉलिसी क्या होगी. सो आई मीन यू डू नॉट रन फॉरन पॉलिसी लाइक अ बुलेना चाइना शॉप. You have to negotiate, you have to talk, you have to discuss. Sometimes you have to give, sometimes you have to take.
So you're supporting.
No, it cannot be.
So you're supporting Mr. Modi and his government.
With the Taliban.
So Vivek Srivastav, is it the eighth wonder of the world that you're supporting Mr. Modi and his government?
Yeah. I am not supporting the Modi government. I am requesting the Modi government not to toe the American line ever. 20 years they have ditched Afghanistan, they are going to ditch you. You need to be non-aligned like we were in the time of Nehru. You need to be non-aligned.
He agrees with everything that the government is doing right now, but in the end, he will never, in the conclusion, he will never say that he agrees with Modi. So, respond to Vivek Srivastav.
No, he's very loyal to his government, Navika. It's just that you know which government he supports. But let me expose his hypocrisy. You know, he has agreed that China is a dictatorship. His leader recently hailed the Chinese government.
I did not.
No, you said we have to maintain. Didn't you say we have to maintain?
We are very democratic. Communist parties are very democratic, sir.
Yeah, he said. You said not talking to non-democracies is not an option.
But Chinese parties are. Navika, please mute him out. Please, Vivek, this is not fair. Did I interrupt you? कॉमरेड आप बार बार ऐसी बात करते हैं. मेरे को जेएनयू समझ के ही शांत हो जाइए.
सिंपल क्वेश्चन.
नहीं नहीं आप एक मिनट रुकिए, क्वेश्चन बाद में आएगा. डॉक्टर आनंद रंगनाथन कंप्लीट कर लें पहले, एक मिनट.
Yes, thank you. Navika, he himself said that India has to maintain for oil, for other things that it requires, maintain relationship with dictatorships. And in the same vein, he said, don't we have relations with Saudi Arabia? Don't we have relations with China? So he agreed that China is a dictatorship. So 2 points here. Number one, when I was talking about that we must move towards having relations only with democracy, I was not talking we should do it tomorrow. Of course we can't. We need the oil, we need so many other minerals and everything, but we have to think for the long term. That's the reason why I talked about D60, maybe 20 years, 30 years down the line. And that will be good for the Chinese people as well, Vivek, because you know, the only way they will realize that we have to have relations with the rest of the democratic world is that they will only trade with us if we are a democracy. Abhi China has, there is no impetus for China to not be draconian, to not be autocratic, because people are dealing with them and they behave as if they are democratic. In fact, they have Indian stooges who do not mind them interning one and a half million Uyghur Muslims in concentration camps.
They have more inner democratic structure.
Vivek, please don't interrupt.
Vivek Srivastav, calm down. I need to get in Sanju Verma. Yeah. Sanju Verma,
yes.
The issue here is...
No, I need 10 seconds. Communist parties are more democratic, Anand Ranganathan ji, compared to social democratic parties.
Communist Chinese Communist Party. I can't believe this.
It is not like the Bharatiya Janata Party ki Modi sahab ne aake nominate kar diya.
Please apologize.
Niche se upar tak chunav hota hai, tab general secretary.
Aap kya keh rahe hain?
Will you let this go? He is saying the Chinese Communist Party is more democratic than the BJP. I can't believe what Vivek has just said.
Dr. Anand Ranganathan, I don't know why you are so outraged, because you just said which is the government he is going to support. I mean, you knew it. Aapko unka DNA pata hai, aapko unka marz pata hai, dawa uski koi hai nahi. To ab aap rehne dijiye na. This is the way it's going to be. But Sanju Verma, I want to ask you the question. The question really is that right now the government is caught between the rock and a hard place. Where are we going from here is a question that the country needs to know.
So Navika, you know, I'm not going to beat around the bush, though of course we are discussing real politics and diplomacy, and I'm reminded of Winston Churchill's famous saying that a diplomat is somebody who thinks twice before saying nothing, you know. But I'll just say one thing, that while discretion is the better part of valor, and foreign policies are not discussed in times now debate. That said, let it not be lost on anyone that the proof of the pudding is in the eating, and in the last 7 years, the Modi government has never negotiated point A with the terror militia. Don't forget that in February this year, we forced like China to voluntarily disengage to its position at Singer 8 near Pangong So. And I don't need lectures from the Congress, because they should realize that Jawaharlal Nehru handed on a golden platter to the Chinese more than 38,000 square kilometers.
Well, the past is the past. The future is what is staring at us. The future is what is staring at us. Sanjay Jha, 30 seconds, because you've been raising your hand, 30 seconds to you. You've muted yourself.
Yeah, Navika, very quickly, can you hear me now?
Yes.
You will go back to the hijacking of the Indian Airlines plane to Kandahar. And you know something? India paid a massive price because the government was not able to negotiate the release of its passengers. They buckled. It is very easy to say, but you know, we have to save the lives. Yes, we have to save the lives, but you needed a government that could negotiate. And the fact of the matter is, it was a major embarrassing security lapse that led to the hijack anyway. You know, you read the autobiography and you get to know that the government was not even aware of a hijack. So the truth of the matter is, this government surrenders at the drop of a hat. The Taliban remains a dangerous entity. And I can tell you, if India is going to strike bargain deals, remove terror from the UN Security Council statement, you are basically surrendering to one of the most dangerous terrorist organizations that is always going to have allegiance to Pakistan.
Well, we are looking for solutions. Sanjay Jha, if you or your erstwhile party, the Congress party, has any solutions that will find, some practical stability and, solving of problems, they're most welcome. Which is why the all-party meeting was held. But in the past, we've seen when there are standoffs that are going on between India and China at Doklam, there is a different kind of party that goes on within the Congress. And that clearly is not the way any international imbroglio or standoff can be resolved. Well, at this moment, let's just say that this really is going to be a wait and watch situation. There are no easy answers. Foreign policy will have to calibrate itself as the days go by and developments are watched from a close quarter. The Prime Minister has set up a monitoring group, which includes not just the Raksha Mantri, Mr. Rajnath Singh, the NSA, the Home Minister, but the fact is that this is a development that will have to be looked at closely, hour to hour, day to day, week to week. What the solution will be finally, even in the shortest possible term, we don't know that yet. Talking about the long term is a long way off. But that's where we leave it tonight, as we watch this space and developments between Taliban, India and the world in the days to come. Taking a short break. On the other side, well, it's the Jallianwala debate. Mr. Rahul Gandhi has a problem with it. He has a problem with the conservation activity there, but he did not have a problem with dogs roaming around insulting the martyrs. Problem with the renovated Jallianwala Bagh Museum, because he thinks it's an insult.